with some of this, with our scheduling, that I was gonna be gone tomorrow for a conference to meet, so, wife switched days to ride the bus, and then last week I realized I gotta be up here for conferences. So, if we can avoid it, we really don't wanna have our dog locked up for more than 8 hours. Yeah, so I'll quit bus home and just let him out, and I'll just let him out, put it back in.
You bring him here. I think she just did it for conferences, I would see him.
What I should do is he should be part of the cross-country practice.
Oh my gosh, yes.
He'd pull you along, all right.
And come watch you guys along. That would make it like my day so much brighter.
Well, see, this battery's about to, about to go, so let me quick switch. See, black Labrador with, a white stripe down the center, whether that's a English settler, maybe. Okay, so now we're live again. Okay, now, when it comes to these dot diagrams, what does your periodic table tell you? Why do you use that table?
The chart.
Well, you can, but as far as dot diagrams are concerned.
But you have to know the electron.
But what electron, no?
The valence electron.
Valence electron. So if we had Ki, okay? So this was our compound. My advice, start with your negative ions, always. Negative, 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 okay? And what we mean by that, since iodine is a halogen, it's in which column? Okay, so that seventh column is telling you something very specific about iodine. Well, true, but how many valence electrons is that?
Seven.
Seven, okay? So, typically, we just want two electrons, whether they're shared or unshared. Notice that these are unshared electrons. We've got seven of them. But then this is one short. Remember, we want to satisfy the octet rule with this exception. This is an exception to that rule. That is a very stable bond. Two hydrogens, because it's diatomic. Okay? But notice that iodine is one short. So where does it get that last electron from? Because potassium is in which column? So it has how many valence electrons in it? Now, notice, you don't have to be putting these boxes around here, but non-metals want 8 electrons around. Metals do not want any electrons. So notice there's nothing around potassium. It wants to get rid of that last electron to become more stable, because what we see happening, remember, if we do this Bohr model, 1s2, 2s2, 2p6, 3s2, 3p6, oops, 6, then there's that electron right there. 10, 18, 19 matches the atomic number, but this is now gone and right here. So now this outer energy level is full, so potassium is now stable. Okay? So it gave that electron away to the iodine here, that gained one. And that's why iodine is negative one and potassium is positive one, because it gave that electron away. Make sense?
Doesn't matter.
Nope, it can be a dot, it can be an X, it can be a slash, it can be an E, any one of them. Now, you can just put all X's around there, but it's easier to see which electrons coming from which element in the form of X's, E's, triangles, dots, whatever you're most comfortable with. Okay, so the last thing I want to do before let's say we had a covalent bond, we haven't spent much time on those. You'll be given time to work on these on Thursday, okay? Because myself will not be here tomorrow, Jordan won't be here tomorrow. We often the conference meet, okay? So with that, let's say we did the cyanide ion, okay? And we're gonna say it's got a negative one charge to it. So that negative one is telling you it has one more what than the total number of protons. It's got one more extra electron. Now, let me show you the wrong way to approach this, okay? Or excuse me, the right way to approach it. But sometimes it's just trial and error. Because do we remember from physical science, these two elements can do something very specific that other elements cannot. What would that possibly be? You're right, but three what?
And over here.
How about, what do you suppose... What do you suppose that means? What type of bond is this? Well, they're both covalent.
We have to start.
Yeah.
Oh, I can't remember the name.
What type of bond is this? It's covalent? Yeah? How many lines is here?
What? Covalent.
That's a single bond. What do you suppose that is?
No,
that's a double bond. What do you suppose that is? Triple bond. Okay? So what that means is these two elements can do any one of these. Just use carbon as an example. So what that means is the logical approach would be starting with a single bond. So let's see if that's right. It's not right, but we'll show you what we mean. If you try a single bond, carbon's in which column? Four. So how many valence electrons is that? So you might try this. There's your four valence electrons. Then you might try nitrogen. Try to make a single bond there. Nitrogen's in which column? So how many valence electrons is that? Do we see what we mean by valence electrons and what column it's in? Does anyone not understand that? Yes.
So,
but don't use that logic. Okay, we don't understand that. What's...
No,
what?
Because you have to add more S block, B block, basically the D block out of there.
Yeah.
So you add the S or the P.
Yeah, you
so
skip the transition metals. Okay.
Gotcha. Okay.
Which number is element 7, right? So 1S2. 2S2. 2 and 3 gives you what? Okay, so what column is nitrogen in? Fifth one.
It's because of the, like you said, the S and the D blocks connected together.
All right, so if we try a single bond, then 1, 2, 3, 4, and then it's kind of like the bus seat rule. You try one on each side and then start pairing your electrons together. Okay? Notice these are shared, these are unshared. Okay? Because they're just on top all by themselves, just resonating and hanging out. So what problem do we see here with this nitrogen bond? It doesn't have an octet around. Okay? So that tells you that a single bond does not work. So let's try a double bond then. So that means two electrons are here for carbon, one there. You can put the other one on the bottom or on the side. It doesn't make any difference. So we try the same thing with nitrogen, a double bond. There's that double bond we're talking about. And then here's two for nitrogen. How many to under eight, okay, and you get to this spot, these will not be separated. You can put them back together. Now, you will get better at that with trial and error, because what would happen is if we just leave that like this, okay, how many more does carbon have? If we got four, can it have any more? Well, it's in column four, so we put all four dots. But what about this nitrogen? How many are around it now? It's got eight, but once you get to this level, you would not have unshared pairs of electrons apart like that. You would put them together. That's why you would write it like that. Okay? So now, notice you got two, four, six, and two more gives you that eight. That's the octet rule. No one would argue with that. But what about this carbon, though? It also has two, four, six. But one more gives you what? Seven. But look at your original formula. What did it say? So you told me correctly that if it has a minus one, that means it's got one extra. So what do you suppose we're going to put inside carbon's box? An extra electron. Now, does carbon have eight electrons around? Four, six, eight. Does this nitrogen have eight electrons? Two, four, six, and eight. So what you'll see happening is that these covalent bonds, or nonmetals, you may have to go through the process of trial and error. You might try a single bond. That didn't work. You might try a double bond. Notice that didn't work. Finally, you may try a triple bond and say, okay, that works. And you don't have to put these boxes around here. That's not necessary. Yes? Yes, from that negative one up there. So let's say, who in this class would we want to get rid of?
I do.
Okay. So Mr. Deitch might get
a laugh on this. We're going to take this negative one off there.
Do you remember what we call this ion? The silanide ion. So if we put this K in front of there, now we've got potassium cyanide. Does that even sound pleasant? No. I think this is what's used in executions for capital punishment. Maybe it's potassium chloride. It's one of them too that interrupts the natural heartbeat and causes it to actually go into fibrillation and stops. It's either potassium chloride or potassium cyanide. That's why we said, who do we want to get rid of? And you people, friends of the class warrior, let's get rid of him. So, since we took that negative one off of there, cyanide, yes, it's got a negative one charge, but potassium has a what charge? Plus. So, from our first example, what happens? This has one extra electron that it gives away. So then, see, there's that potassium that gave that electron. Okay? Could you repeat that question? It did not make any sense. Yeah, it's not just the nitrogen. It's the cyanide ion. Okay, so I need to jet, so we will pick up with this again at a later time. You'll be given time on Wednesday and Thursday to complete this. All right, until next time.